today's lecture by Professor Payal Nagpal, who teaches English in JDM College, Delhi University, would be on The Quiet American, the novel written by Graham Greene. This is a penultimate lecture in this series, which means that the next lecture will be the last one. After that, we will have a general series of lectures, three or four, next month. That will be followed by another series, and we will duly inform you when that series happens. So, before I request Professor Nagpal to speak on The Quiet American, let me make one simple remark about this novel. This novel belongs to our times. This novel was written in the 1950s, and the Second World War was over, and the world had changed vitally after that. The interests of the world and the countries in it were not the same as they were before the war. But in certain parts of the world, the war, in a way, continued. That was the case with Vietnam, and the British author, Graham Greene, he took it upon himself to visit the place, to see it, to study it, to find the implications of what was going on there, and then he composed a very intense novel. This novel's intensity is really impressive. It has a lot of pain. It has a serious engagement with the kind of politics that goes on in the world, particularly by the oppressors, and they compel other people to fight them, and the fight is always unequal. That is the case with this novel, and you can see when you read the novel, you will see that the characters have been drawn particularly to the effect of seeing the world as a divided world. So, without further ado, I request Dr. Payal Nagpal to please give a lecture.
Thank you, Professor Prakash. So, as you rightly put it, and it's important that we must put this novel into perspective, because the novel was written in the 1950s, as you rightly pointed out, and was published somewhere around 1955. So, this is clearly the period after the Second World War, the kind of decade that follows. And in the aftermath of the Second World War, it was very difficult post Hiroshima and Nagasaki for people to kind of make sense of the world and to understand that humanity that had worked towards progress, that had worked towards development, innovation, technology, what has been the end result is the question that people were grappling with. And they were doing this in their own very, very different ways. So, for instance, the theories of Jean-Paul Sartre, existentialism, for instance, or Camus' idea of the absurd, these are all ideas that were prevalent in the 1950s. And it's an interesting decade, because this is a decade that is also primarily known for drama. It's a decade during which a lot of the playwrights, who have, of course, been clubbed at times, incorrectly so, under the umbrella term of the theatre of the absurd. But the one thread that was common amongst all these writers was their very different ways of trying to make sense of the absurdity of life in the post-Second World War era. So, at a time like this, Graham Greene writes a novel titled The Quiet American. And what does he really speaking mean by The Quiet American? And what is the craft of writing the novel? What is Greene's craft? How is he evolving the technique of writing the novel? I think, in this shift in the 19th century, we have the realist novel, we have the naturalistic novel towards the end of the 19th century. And in the 20th century, early 20th century is replete with what we call modernist writing. And of course, the writers kind of, contribute in their own different ways to it. But how is it that Greene is able to kind of write the novel and in a sense, through his novel, comment on the very craft of writing a novel? So the modern novel and Greene's Quiet American and of course other novels are a very major contribution here. So Graham Greene, was an English writer and journalist, and he was born in 1904, and he lived till about 1991. and he's an English writer. He wrote a number of novels, also kind of what we understand to be like thrillers. One preoccupation, however, was there in his novels throughout, which was, of course, a preoccupation also of the period after the Second World War and as we moved into the Cold War era. So, which was that of religion. What was the meaning of religion in this world? And he questions it and asks, and particularly, the questions related to Catholicism are taken up in a lot of his novels. So he was also shortlisted for the Nobel Prize in 1966 and 1967. And very famous novels like Brighton Rock, The Power and the Glory, and End of an Affair. He was also awarded with the Jerusalem Prize. Now, when we talk about Green's style of writing, he had worked with the Times from about 1926 to 1930. So he also takes on the what we can call the journalistic style of writing, and how he kind of brings it into, when he talks about reportage, what does it mean to report in a sense, when you write for a particular paper, what does it mean to bring in the idea of reportage? So he creates a very racy novel, and which at the same time is not merely reportage, but it has the speed of almost like a whodunit, because The Quiet American begins with the declaration that one of the characters, Alden Pyle, has been murdered. So the novel is, of course, divided into four parts, and what is very important before we actually start with the discussion of the novel is to understand the history of Vietnam in the 1950s. So it was a part of it was under French occupation, and this is the time that there is a conflict that emerges between the group that is called the Viet Minh and is supported by the communists, and you have the French colonization in a sense and occupation of Vietnam. And there is a suggestion in the novel about what is referred to as the third way through the character of Alden Pyle. And in a sense then, Green is exploring what really is the path ahead, because things seem to be crumbling, but he does not in that sense kind of take a pessimistic view, but actually asserts his role as a writer to say that, you have to kind of make a choice, and the choice has to be guided by a humanitarian understanding of the world. So, of course, he wrote a number of short stories as well. So, The Quiet American, as I mentioned, is a novel that he starts writing around 1951, and it's published in 1955. So, the influence of the existential idea of the fact that you exist and existence precedes essence is something that is somewhere there, in the background, in almost like the very climate of the book, and the whole idea of grappling with the absurd is also there. So the novel is situated in the city of Saigon of Vietnam and a French colony, and the conflict here, as I said, between the two parts of the French and the Viet Minh is something that is brought to fore, and what one sees is a complete collapse with a lot of people actually getting killed in the process. Now the protagonist here is a journalist. He's not a very young man, he's a kind of middle-aged man called Fowler, and his objective is impartial, because he says his function is to report, and so he cannot kind of hold an opinion, because his job is to report. And so he navigates the reader in a sense through an impartial perspective to events all around. Two more characters in this particular novel, that are there in the forefront. One is Phuong, and the other is Alden Pyle. So Phuong is a young Vietnamese girl, and she's in a relationship with Fowler. And Pyle is an American who's come to Vietnam as part of what is referred to as the economic aid mission that was started by America in Vietnam. And he's greatly influenced by what is called by a writer called York Hardin, and who has written a novel like The Advance of Red China. So this is, in a sense, you know, a brief overview of three very important characters, because in a sense the novel you know, kind of circumnavigates around the lives of these people and their relationships. So if you look at the craft of the novel in a sense begins at the end. You know, what do we mean by that? We mean by that that you know, it begins at the point where Pyle has been killed, and nobody knows why and what. So there is, in a sense, the exploration through the course of the novel of the question of who has really kind of you know, killed Pyle. And at the same time, it it's not simply a kind of whodunit narrative. It is a narrative that is very firmly rooted and placed, in a sense, in the political history of Vietnam. So the conventional plot structure in that sense is totally belied, and there is none of the, you know, the kind of fragmented narrative that we have in modernist writing. That's not something that we see here. So you know, where there is the suspense that is maintained about what is really speaking happened, there's also a shuttling back and forth in time, yet Green firmly takes the reader through it all. So the novel begins with the killing of Alden Pyle, the American, and the plot meanders back and forth in time to show us what happened, you know, at the level of the plot, while showing us, really speaking, what was happening in Vietnam. And here I'd like to bring Professor Prakash in and ask him what he thinks about a craft of this sort.
Professor Pyle Nagpal, you have put the net very wide. There are lots of issues you have raised, and the important ones which are near the center are the issues of the technique, of the form, as well as of the intention of the writer. And in fact, as I see this novel, with your help and description, I find that this novel uses the technique of the detective novel, the novel, as you put it, as whodunit. And there is a murder in the beginning, and that murder finally is revealed through a process, which is a long process of examination. And that's how the novel evolves in the mind of the reader. So I believe that this technique really helped Graham Greene to establish the authenticity of the narrative in a new way. This was the case with the 19th century interesting novels, and the novel's interest had waned in the early 20th century, when people went into stream of consciousness, when they went into, as you said, the idea of absurdity and all those things, and the novel was losing hold of the on the mind of the reader. Then this person enters the scene, and he makes novel once again interesting. But the interest, you know, doesn't cost anything to the audience, because he's raising political issues. Yes. And I like the phrase particularly used by you, political history. So it's an all about the political history, and political history generally is shunned by people in the post Second World War. In fact, there is a phrase that became current, and Professor Nagpal would also touch upon it, I'm sure, is the idea of the Cold War. Yes. So the war has ended, but Cold War has begun. So hot war, which was involving destruction, which was so much of use of weaponry, that is over for the time being. Of course, that is not over. I mean, it's irony, that's not over in Vietnam. But then Cold War is on. And I particularly liked your use of the word economic aid mission. So somebody comes, you know, as a part of the economic aid mission to help Vietnam, and this person is a kind of a spy. This person is, you know, siphoning off useful data about Vietnam situation back to the masters. The double irony is, because you brought in those details, the double irony is that the person who is who is perpetrating this kind of crime of espionage, this person doesn't know that he's a part of the crime. Yes. And that, you know, calls this novel, might help us call this novel multi-layered, because the hero is an innocent person. And his innocence is dangerous, because the more innocent he is, the more people will believe in him. So these are the issues, and I think I agree with you that the interest of the novel particularly engages the reader with very serious political problems. Yes, is what I said.
Absolutely. And you so rightly pointed out the context of the Cold War, because the two massive blocs, you know, one with the West and the other represented by Russia, the two blocs were there. And that also kind of generated, a different political climate in the world. So here I'd like to just kind of read out a quotation right at the beginning that's written in a note by Green himself. He says, "This is a story and not a piece of history. And I hope that as a story about a new, about a few imaginary characters, it will pass for both of you one hot Saigon evening." So he's addressing some friends back in Vietnam. But much as he says that it's a story and not a piece of history, I think he's doing it deliberately, because the political history of Vietnam is what forms, in a sense, the base of this novel, through which Green kind of takes the reader and allows the reader to explore the different aspects and to examine, you know, what has really speaking been the end result, and what has, for instance, be it the French occupation or be it the conflict with the Viet Minh, what has it done to the people of Vietnam? And that is the crucial question here, in a sense. So he says, "You can rule me out," I said, "I'm not involved." I repeated. It had been an article of my creed. The human condition being what it was, let them fight, let them love, let them murder. I would not be involved. And he says, "My fellow journalists call themselves correspondents. I preferred the title of reporter. I wrote what I saw. I took no action. Even an opinion is a kind of action." So this is a comment by Fowler in the novel. Very early on, I think, you know, part one, I think it's probably the second chapter, that Fowler says that, you know, "My fellow journalists call themselves correspondents," but he says he prefers the title of the reporter, and says that even an opinion is a kind of action. We need to compare this comment with what he really speaking, does at the end of the novel, where he says that at times it's important to actually choose and decide in favor of humanity. And so we must keep this in mind. Yet at the level of a narrator, at the level of said earlier also about the craft of the novel, it's important to understand that this kind of an objective view is, it's very interesting, because this kind of an objective perspective is what we see in the 19th century novel. And it's fascinating to see how Green is combining different, as Professor Prakash said, that it's multi-layered. So we are looking at different layers of a kind of very, very adventurous thriller. We want to know, really speaking, exactly what happened to Pyle. That's one part of it. We also want to know what's going on in Vietnam. And all these tropes, we want to know what's happening with Phuong. What does she think? And all these layers are brought out, not in a kind of fragmented manner, but in an extremely layered manner with great clarity. And that is, really speaking, the genius of Graham Greene. So, very early in the novel again, Pyle is referred to as a very quiet American. So, Pyle is not just a quiet American himself, but he's representative, in a sense, of the quiet American who has, in a sense, who's come here as part of the economic aid mission. But what Pyle does is he's greatly influenced, first of all, by the writings of York Harding and the Third Way. And so he starts thinking about what is the possible third way, and unfortunately kind of allies with, the new force that is there emerging out of the Cao Dynasty at that time, which is that of General Thay. And he's part of some, very unfortunate bombings that take place over there. So this is an idea that is, reinforced by Vico, the police officer who's working on the case. So the question is, really speaking, been posed right at the beginning. So one of the things when Fowler describes Pyle, he says democracy was another subject of his, and he had pronounced and aggravating views on what the United States was doing for the world, democracy and the responsibility of the West. So we can see that the landscape is changing, and which is why very often Greens, the Quiet American, is considered to be very obviously prophetic for reasons that follow. So democracy, in a sense, you know, he says, was something that Pyle thought about, and he thought about the responsibility of the West. Now, this is then, we also have in the backdrop the entire colonial agenda and so on. But now it's not that kind of colonization, really speaking, that we are looking at. What we're looking at is Pyle, who's there, you know, as part of a mission, which is to provide aid. And in fact, there is a point at which there is a reference to the economic aid by Fowler in terms of, you know, supplying sewing machines and so on. So now we need to ask, so what is the narrative style? Is it mere reportage? Are we looking at a slice of crime fiction? Are we looking at a slice of history? But again, this is a kind of writing that engages with the context and at the same time engages, really speaking, with the reader. So here I'd like to ask Professor Prakash, that would you agree with me that, you know, somewhere Green is also very intelligently using the tropes of popular fiction also and bringing them in to kind of, really speaking, comment on the political landscape, something that he possibly cannot do very directly?
Well, that's an interesting question, because the writer is swearing by the word reporting. And when he reports, then of course there's a choice required. What do you report? How do you report it? How do you tell the reader something that is hidden in the reporting? All these questions become very challenging for the author at this time, and the writer cannot but be conscious about this aspect. So I would agree with you that the hero of the novel is quiet, and the writer of the novel is intelligent and clever. And that it's a deadly combination, because the Graham Greene understands what is going on in Vietnam at that point of time. And so far, friends, we have discussed this novel from the point of view of its effect on the reader, its appeal, and we also will take up shortly. We'll take up the question of the characters, the question of the situation, the question of pain. The question of deprivation and poverty, all those things, because they are reflected indirectly through the lens of what Professor Pyle Nagpal called reporting. So that's what we have so far done. Dr. Pyle Nagpal has talked about the narrative, the strategy behind the narrative, to make the narrative strong and appealing for the reader, and to draw the reader into the world, you know, that one lives in at that point of time. So it's a discussion that has gone along fine lines of fiction writing in the present era, and that's a good beginning for discussing the novel. Thank you.